Hey friends, welcome back to the channel. My name is Sanj and today we're going to talk about superannuation. Now I know what you're thinking, it's an incredibly boring topic, but incidentally it is also quite an important topic when it comes to sorting out your personal finances, along with budgeting, investing in the share market, real estate. Superannuation is also something that you should at least be across, broadly speaking, to sort out your finances. Now in today's video, we're going to touch on some of the basics around superannuation. We'll also touch on briefly around that whole idea of putting more money into your super and why some of your friends might say, you know, I'm putting in 12, 13, 14, 15% into my superannuation account and where the tax savings come from. We'll then pivot to some of the tips and tricks that Scott Pape from The Barefoot Investor talks about in his book and some of the key things he calls out around your superannuation. And we'll finish off with some risks, I guess, associated with putting too much money into your superannuation. Because nothing is perfect and nothing is bulletproof and things can go wrong. And there are reasons why you shouldn't put everything into superannuation, even though there are certain taxation benefits associated with it. As always, I'll leave below some links so you can jump across in terms of the timestamps to any specific section of the video you want to. I'll also leave below some links towards books or websites that you might find handy when it comes to sorting out your superannuation. So let's get into it. So when it comes to our superannuation, we tend to leave it a bit on the sidelines, mainly because it's, number one, too hard to find out how much money we've even invested in it or sitting in it because we don't know the login details. You can't find that piece of paper that you get once a year from your superannuation account saying, you know, this is how much you put into it, this is how much you got from your investments, and this is how much we took in fees. Very rare, very hard to find those things. I personally didn't know how much was in my superannuation until I started properly logging in through my phone app. But that's one thing. The other thing is it's sort of complicated. We're not really sure where that money is being invested. It's not really clear and transparent. And I think because of that, we tend to leave our superannuation off to the side. It's sort of something we don't really think about. But the reality is of the money we earn, about 10% actually does go into super. That's basically because the Australian government, and I think this is what Barefoot Investor said in his book, doesn't trust us to save for our retirement. So they actually force us through our employer to set aside 10% of everything we earn to go towards superannuation. So if you want to find out how much money you have, obviously the first thing is you have to log into your superannuation account. I have done a video in the past, it was a bit hit and miss, but it's pretty easy to go and find those login details and log in for the first time. Then the second thing is you want to find out where your money is actually invested. Where is it allocated? Now, if we use averages, Australian Superannuation, which is a big Australian super company here in Australia, says about 90% of their accounts are invested through the balanced option. Now, the balanced option is like the default option. If you haven't touched your superannuation since it's been set up, it's probably set up in a balanced option. And when you look on their website, they clearly call out where that balanced option is actually invested. So where is your money invested? And they say it's about 21% in Australian shares and about 30% in international shares. So immediately you can see off the bat, about 50% of your money invested in superannuation is going to be in the Australian share market. And this explains why, if you actually look at your super in detail, you look at the numbers, the amount of money you've put in through the company you work for is not equal to the amount of money you have in super, because it's the amount of money you put in plus the investment earnings you've gotten from the share market that's resulted in your superannuation balance. That's why it's always a bit like, oh, I didn't realize I had that much money in there. It's probably because you put in a certain amount and then it's been invested in the share market and it's generated these extra returns as well. That's why it's always a little bit more than you expect. So when it comes to putting money into your superannuation and taxation and this whole topic that people talk about around, you should put more money into your super because you'll save in tax, where's that all coming from? Well, the best way to sort of explain it is to follow, let's say, $100 from the company you're earning and follow it through to your normal bank accounts versus what would happen if it goes through to your super. So let's say you earn $100 from the company you're working for and you're on a salary around, you know, under $120,000, a very standard salary in the very normal range, 80, 90, 100,000, around there, where your tax bracket on that additional earnings is around 32 cents or 32 and a half cents on the dollar. So let's round it up to 33 cents. So if you're earning $100 and it goes into your normal account, that $100 gets taxed, about $33 gets held for tax, and you only see 67 cents in your account, generally speaking, using averages here, but that's the idea of what happens. Now, if that $100 actually goes into your superannuation account, any money that goes into your super gets taxed at 15%, not your normal rate, which is around 33%. only gets taxed at 15 cents. So automatically, you're going to see more money in your super. So you'll see about $85 in your super for that $100. So the same $100, if it goes into your normal accounts, your normal bank accounts with Commonwealth Bank or whatever, it will get taxed at a higher rate, versus if that $100 goes into your super, it gets taxed only at 15%, 33% against 15%. So immediately some of you are going to be thinking, oh, I get it. That's where the tax saving comes from, because it's tax savings are hard, because it's not like you see the money. It's more a case of the Australian government takes less money from you. And that's what's happening, is instead of taking 33 cents for every dollar you're earning, they only take 15 cents for every dollar you're earning. So this is why there are some people who say, I'll put more money towards my super because I can save money through tax. And there are websites you can use that can give you a bit of an estimate. One of my favorites is paycalculator.com.au. And on this website, you put in how much money you're earning. So whatever it is, $100,000, $90,000, $80,000, you say if it includes super. And then you go down along the left-hand side, I believe, there's a little section where you can say, what if I salary sacrifice a little bit more in? Salary sacrificing, it's got some negative connotations to it, but it's essentially saying, instead of earning that money normally, I'll sacrifice some of my money and put it towards my superannuation. If I salary sacrifice, say, an extra $10, $20, $30 a week, a fortnight, whatever it is, this website will automatically tell you how much money you'll save in terms of tax from it. It's very handy, very handy. But it's obviously an estimate. Speak to your financial advisors and your accountants to get a more accurate estimate. But that's the idea, is if you put, instead of sending a dollar towards your normal account, you sacrifice and you send it towards your superannuation, you can actually save money in tax, which is another way of saying you lose less money towards tax than if you just kept it in your normal account. So after hearing that key piece around where your superannuation is going and why some people are keen to put more money towards their superannuation, what do some of the pros like Scott Pape from The Barefoot Investor say when it comes to superannuation? Because in his book, he called out a few things, and I've pulled out about five things that he called out regarding superannuation and some key tips and tricks. So the first tip is consolidating your accounts. And this is because the average Australian has something like two, three, maybe four accounts under their name. And that's because, you know, we have different jobs in our life. We might have started with some internships or at university. The casual job we did maybe had some superannuation associated with it. Before you know it, you might have two or three accounts. The first thing and the most important thing you can do is try and consolidate your superannuation just down into one account. Generally, maybe the account you're currently with your current job. Try and bring all your super from all your different jobs you've had in the past all into the one account. And the main reason for that is you can save on fees. There's no point paying fees across all these different accounts. And there's no need to necessarily have lots of different accounts because you're thinking it's like a diversification strategy. Most superannuation accounts are diversified within themselves. So there's no need to have like four or five accounts because you're worried one will fall apart. They're usually pretty reliable, so it's worth consolidating all into one account. And it's quite easy. I've found the company you're with, the superannuation company you're currently with, you can usually use them to help you consolidate because it's in their best interest to get all the money to them. The current accounts, the other accounts you're with, they're usually not that helpful because they're going to lose your money, right? So usually you can use the company you're with. On their website, they'll usually have links or forms that you need to fill in. You only have to fill it in once, and they can help collect all your superannuation from all your different companies you've worked from in the past. The second tip he calls out is around making sure you're finding an account, once you've consolidated, that has low fees, because you can lose quite a lot of money in terms of fees. And in his book, he gave an example of, say you started working when you're 20, by the end of your working age, you might have around $600,000-$700,000 in terms of your super. In that time, if you don't optimize for fees, you might end up paying like $100,000, $170,000 in fees. And he gave an example of that. And this is all because if you don't try and find an account that pays relatively low in fees, you'd end up wasting money towards all those fees that you pay that you could get a cheaper option if you shopped around a bit for your superannuation. So this has actually become a little bit easier because now the Australian government has gotten on board and started to show where you can get low fees, or you can see how your superannuation account compares to other superannuation accounts out there in terms of fees. The only thing you have to look out for is some superannuation accounts are like closed and they're not open to everybody. Like only certain types of jobs or certain types of employees can get superannuation accounts with these particular companies. Other accounts or other supers are open, anyone can join up. So that's just one thing to be conscious of, but you can check out various websites where they'll show you how your super compares to other super accounts out there and how much you could potentially save in terms of fees in that case. Now, once you've found the cheap superannuation company to go with, the other thing is you can also find within them, they might have different superannuation products and one of them might be relatively cheap compared to the other. And in this situation, Scott Pape in the Barefoot Investor book called out Host Plus Index Diversified option, where instead of charging quite a high annual fee, they charge quite a low fee because that you ended up investing essentially in index funds through a superannuation account. So they had relatively low fees. And that's something he recommended in his book. Obviously, do your own research, but that's also what I ended up doing, was taking Host Plus and then taking their Index Diversified option. So obviously, do your own research, check out the different fees, but that's an example where, you know, you start off by consolidating accounts, then you find a superannuation provider that's relatively cheap. Then from there, you can narrow down even further. Within that superannuation provider, they might have different options and one of them might be more appropriate for you. So the third tip he called out in his book, which I thought was quite interesting, was around self-managed superannuation funds. And often when you go on your superannuation optimization journey, people will call out, oh yeah, I've considered, you know, running my own super. So you get to allocate your own investments, you get to pick exactly where you invest it and all of that. You're essentially running your own superannuation account. But the downside of this that he called out in his book is there's a lot of compliance costs that can go around with it. So while you get to invest how you want to, there could be additional costs that you're not across that if you were investing directly through the superannuation company, you wouldn't have to pay. So that's one thing that he calls out, that he said he tried it, he didn't like it, and he switched back to just investing through like a Host Plus, like a normal superannuation company. But he did call out there's this option called SMSF Lite, where you get the benefits of running your own superannuation, but you don't have the costs and the stress of managing your own superannuation. And he called this out where some supers have direct investment options. So I've seen this in Host Plus. I think I've also seen it in Australian Super. And it's where basically the superannuation company will say you can choose our pre-allocated options, or you can choose to invest directly in the share market if you're confident and, you know, you want to take on that risk with your superannuation money. So this has certain benefits because, remember, the money's not getting taxed as high as it was when it was going through to your normal accounts. When it goes through the super, only gets taxed at 15%. And you can pick where it goes, so you don't have to leave it to these investment managers to do. Now, obviously, there are risks because you're picking and, you know, it's all on you. And, yeah, I guess that's the main thing. But that being said, you don't have the downside of having to pay all that additional compliance costs or accounting costs. I'm not across it myself, but Barefoot says there are all these additional costs that you have to pay by running your own superannuation. So you're getting basically Australian Super to handle all of that. And I think in his book, he actually does say he does a bit of both. So he has his normal superannuation account where he lets Australian Super do some of their own investing, but he also has a little bit where he invests directly in the share market through his superannuation. So last tip I'll call out from his book where Scott Pape goes into superannuation is he's actually structured the book so that he calls out putting more money into your superannuation as something to do after you've bought a house. So his book is sort of set around, you know, get your budgeting in order, get your buckets in order, buy a house, then put more money into superannuation. Now, this is in the face of the obvious benefits in terms of tax that you see immediately from putting more money into super. He's sort of calling out that you can do that, but do it after you've put money into buying a house and you've bought a house and you can make your mortgage repayments. Then once you've sorted all that out, take your superannuation amount from 10 to 15%. At the time of the book, it was actually 9.5%. But now for everyone since 1st of July 2021, it's actually gone up to 10%. But he essentially says, take it up to 15% once you've started putting money, once you've got a house and you can pay off your mortgage. So I thought that was interesting how he structured it. I guess from his point of view, he's seeing that, you know, the benefits of buying a house outweigh the benefits of, say, putting more money into super in the early days. You should focus on getting a deposit as big as possible, then buy the house, then optimize your super for the long run. So this whole thing around don't put money into super until you've bought a house connects in nicely to some of the risks that I want to call out as well when it comes to your superannuation. And I think it's kind of connected to the first risk I'll call out, which is you can't actually touch the money in your superannuation until you're older, until you're at least 60, 65, somewhere in that range. So the rules are very specific. You can check your particular superannuation account if you want to, but you generally can't touch the money that you've put into your superannuation account until you're a bit older. Now, this can be a bit of a risk if you're, say, someone who's looking to retire early, meaning before you hit 60, 65, because you don't want to put too much money into your superannuation such that when you retire, say when you're 40, 45, you're left in this situation where you don't actually have any money to live on. You've got like a massive amount of money in your superannuation account, like millions of dollars, let's say. But you can't actually touch it because you're only 40, 45 and you haven't actually reached the age at which the Australian government says you can touch your superannuation account. So that's a bit of a balancing act you have to find. And I guess that's where you'll see these various FIRE blogs and these FIRE accounts where they'll say you need to find that balance between putting money into your superannuation account, because there's obvious taxation benefits, both in terms of putting the money in and the money it earns in there. It only gets taxed at 15%. Balanced with, you need to have enough money from when you do retire early that you can live on until you hit the age at which you can access your superannuation. So it's a nice optimization problem to try and solve, and there are various Excel spreadsheets out there, and we'll look at them in the future, but that's an interesting balancing act. So if you're someone who's really keen to retire early, be careful of putting too much money into your super because you can't actually touch it till you're 60. You're going to find some kind of strategy where you can put enough into your super so that you're going to be happy when you're 60, but also you've got enough to live on if you retire early until you can access your super. That's the first risk. The other risk is around what I would call legislation risk, which is basically a lot of the benefits around super come from the tax and the rules that the Australian government has put around superannuation. Now, they can very quickly change those rules, and that's something you have to be ready for. So an example of something they could change is they could change the age at which you can access your superannuation. So it's currently around 60, 65. They could bump that up to 70, 75. And you're caught because you're like, you've got all this money in your super, and you put it in there because there's all these benefits of tax, but you can't actually access it. You have to work an extra 10 years or whatever it is till you can get there. That's something to consider. Another thing they could do is they could change some of the taxation rules around it. So currently it's 15% in terms of the money going in, and I think it's only 15% in terms of the money you earn inside your superannuation. And then the money you take out of your superannuation, I'm pretty sure there are favorable tax rules around that as well. So they could change some of those rules as well in the future, and that could make it less favorable. Now, it can get worse, but I don't think that would take away from all the benefits that there are now in it. Like, you know, even if they took it up to 20% in terms of the money you send into your super, that's still generally better than what most of us are paying in terms of the 32.5% in tax that we're paying. So that's something to consider. So again, it's a risk. Because it's so reliant on government rules around it, the government could change those rules and that might not work out for us in terms of people who are putting more into their super for whatever reason. So yeah, so that's the key thing to consider is over the next 20, 30 years, what could the Australian government do to screw me over in terms of superannuation? That's probably the best way to think about it. And how sensitive would I be to those changes? How reliant am I on the money I'm putting into my super? And I guess you've got to balance that with someone who's going to be working till they're 60, who's happy to do that, versus someone who, say, wants to retire when they're 35, 40, 45, 50. How do you balance those risks? I'm not sure myself. I just know these are risks and the things to consider. But yeah, it could all go south very quickly if the Australian government wanted to. I don't think the Australian government would, mainly because there's a lot of votes in superannuation, because a lot of people across the age spectrum are looking towards good things in superannuation, I guess. So it's in the government's general interest to have superannuation as a favourable thing. There's a lot of votes in it, but you never know. They could do their own thing and it could all go south. So just be aware of that risk. You're relying a lot on it versus, say, investing in the share market through your normal brokerage accounts where it's a lot more transparent And the only things you have to consider there are really your taxes. But outside of that, there's not too much in terms of rules around when you can access that money. Thanks so much for watching the video this far. Hopefully you got some good tips in there around superannuation. I will do some videos in the future regarding, you know, how you can maximize your superannuation in terms of pumping as much as you can into it without it being negatively impacted by taxes, should we say, and also my own superannuation strategy. But I just wanted to start with like a base video to kind of get started on when it comes to a foundational understanding around superannuation. Please do check out some of my other videos around ETFs and investing in the share market. Consider subscribing to the channel and also consider subscribing to my newsletter, which you can see in the link below. That's it for today, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.